now my great pleasure and honor to invite Howard Marks to the Bema to deliver our Devar Torah.
To some, Mishpatim may appear to resemble the Virginia Penal Code. Rabbi Kerry Olitsky, executive director of the Jewish Outreach Institute, says, "These rules that we heard this morning seem mundane, especially when compared to the grandeur of the previous week's scene at Mount Sinai. There is no story here, no bold narrative. This is a simple lesson. It is not merely on the occasion of Sinai, to which few of us ever witness. When we experience the divine, it is something that occurs in our everyday lives. Perhaps the reason that Torah chooses to use the Hebrew word mishpatim, or ordinances, rather than mitzvot, commandments, is to emphasize that these issues are relevant for us and for our society, and their interaction with groups. And it is in the interaction with others, even those outside of the camp of Israel, which this parasha helps us to navigate, that the sacred can be found. And there are plenty of rules. To be exact, 53 of the 613 mitzvot. I did my own inventory, and I found that probably only about 22 of the 53 are really applicable today. But those 20 are still important to us as Jews as we live our day-to-day lives. Rabbi Diane Kohler Esses, the first Syrian Jewish woman to be ordained a rabbi, said, "This is what happened to the narrative. Beforehand, we were reading a story of what happened to others in history. Now, we read the text and we are commanded to become actors and actresses. I am now subject to the laws. I am addressed through this sacred text that we heard this morning. It's extremely personal." And what are the ordinances? And we heard them this morning from Cantor Steinberg that affect us at this very moment. Just a few. Murder by deliberately striking the victim. Murder because of treachery. Kidnapping. Spreading false rumors, not providing protective fencing around a hole that you've dug on your property so someone doesn't fall in and get injured, accepting bribes, rendering false testimony, eating meat with milk, and if you lend money to the poor, you are not supposed to impose interest. Now, as an illustration of how contemporary today's Torah portion is, Mishpatim, all I have to take is yesterday's Wall Street Journal. Yesterday's Wall Street Journal, and on the opinion page, there is a commentary written by a Tamar Snyder entitled, "When Religion Restricts Lending." And if you just bear with me, I will read you a little portion of that article. "This Saturday, synagogues will chant from the Torah portion of Mishpatim, from the book of Exodus, which is the source of the injunction against charging interest to a fellow Jew. When you lend money to my people, to the poor among you, do not act towards them as a creditor. Exact no interest from them." Shana Novak, executive director of the Hebrew Free Loan Society of New York, explains, "The Jewish tradition translated this biblical injunction into a powerful imperative. Help your neighbor in need and create lasting impact without embarrassment through an interest-free loan. In recent years, we have these microfinance programs that have occurred throughout the world, from Bangladesh to New York. And the Talmud explains that the lending of money without interest merits an even greater reward than giving charity. Rashi says, one of the foremost commentators of our people, explained that loans preserve the debtor's dignity, and interest-free business loans were at the top of Maimonides' ladder of charitable giving, since they foster independence. But I'd rather focus on two other ordinances that were mentioned today in Mishpatim. One, you shall not mistreat a stranger, nor shall you oppress him, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. And the second, and you shall not oppress a stranger, for you know the feelings of the stranger, which you, when you were strangers in the land of Egypt, Mitzrayim. Rabbi Shifa Gold, in her book, Torah Journeys, thinks it is not such a simple or natural assumption to treat the stranger with kindness. She writes, those who suffer oppression often go on to oppress others. This is why we need this mitzvah to be repeated so often in the Torah. According to Rabbi Lawrence Kushner, it would be forgivable if we permitted ourselves the solace of dwelling on our victimization as slaves, but instead we celebrate it, reshape it, and into most frequently repeated explanation of any law in the Torah, over and over and again. We heard this morning from the Bima when we brought out the Torah. Our slavery, instead of embittering us, generates an obligation to identify with anyone who is socially powerless or politically disenfranchised. Rabbi Ishmar Short says, not once, but twice, does our parasha warn us against abusing the vulnerable non-Israelite in our midst. And each time the admonition is anchored in the past, history clearly impacts us here on the spirit and the contours of the halakha. The bitter taste of slavery honed Israel's moral sense. Rabbi Charles Schulman said, when we let God into ourselves, we open our hearts to a world where we see that we've made like us in the common image of the divinity. The ancient Jews were told by the lawgiver Moses to remember the stranger. That is to challenge to them to build a future where nobody on this earth would be a stranger. And Hermann Cohn said, the stranger was to be protected, although he was not a member of one's family, clan, or religion, a community or people, simply because he was a human being. In the stranger, therefore, man discovered the idea of humanity. So thank you so much, and have a very good day. Boker Tov.